In my speech. Wonderful. Wonderful. Okay. Now here's what we're going to do. First, we're going to hear a 5-minute speech from Bill Dean. Then we're going to break into small groups and discuss it. Then each group has a reporter that comes back to the whole group. I'm lying. We don't gonna do that. I want to introduce Mr. William Dean. And I don't know Bill very well, so I asked him to tell me what he'd like me to say about him so that I didn't make something up. And he did. Bill Dean was born and raised in Seattle. After college in New York and graduate school in California, he joined the chemical engineering faculty at MIT in 1976. He and his wife moved that year to Bedford, where they have happily remained after retirement. His earliest memories of trains dates from when, as a preschooler, he was allowed to venture to a place at the end of his street where he could look down on the tracks along Puget Sound. That and toy trains evolved into an interest in scale model railroading and railroad history, which became lifetime hobbies. He wrote hobbies, I think maybe passion. He's particularly fond of steam locomotives and has traveled widely to watch and photograph them in operation. Although he came to Bedford too late to know the local railroad firsthand, retirement provided an opportunity to dig deeply into its 135-year history. And his book, Minuteman Railroad, have you got one with you?
I have some flyers on the table.
He has flyers on the table. It's gorgeous. It's like, it's really nice. We have one in the Historical Society, so we can save it forever. It was published last year. He's been a member of the Friends of Bedford Depot Park since its first year in 1995, and an officer since 2011, and he currently serves as its president. Mr. Dean, make it so.
Thank you, Sharon. How's the volume? Is it okay? Yeah. Thank you, Sharon, and thank you the rest of you for coming today. I'm going to tell you about our local railroad. A couple of things at the start. I realize that one has to be of a certain age to even know what the Boston Main Railroad is or was, and so I'm starting with that. The Boston Main was a railroad system that, before the advent of motor vehicles, dominated long-distance passenger and freight transport in northern New England. Its network, as shown here on the map, extended from Massachusetts up into Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, and even upstate New York. It peaked in mileage around World War I at over 2,000 route miles. By the time the date of this map, 1941, it had suffered some attrition, but still was a formidable regional transportation network. Now the Lexington branch, and I see that it's cut off there. I wonder if we can.
If you pull back,
yeah,
you'll get more on the screen.
Wait a minute.
Yes.
So we apologize for the technical difficulties. Anyway, so the Boston-Maine system was at one time over 2,000 miles. The Lexington branch, our local railroad, was just a tiny part of that. So I guess the first fact is that what happened in the Boston-Maine system had a big effect on what happened locally with our own railroad, but not so much the reverse. There was one exception that I'll mention. Another thing to keep in mind is that although only 20-some miles, the local railroad lasted a long time. And in the five towns that it served, which I've referred to in my book as Minuteman towns, in doing so, it affected a lot of lives over the years. And its longevity is illustrated by this couple of pictures of a drawing of what the first train looked like and a photo of the actual last train. Our railroad had a very unusual origin, or you could call it sort of a pre-origin. And it's with a very unlikely industry, which is the harvesting and export overseas of natural ice. The harvesting was done in what is now Cambridge's Fresh Pond and Arlington's Spy Pond, and at one time was the largest source of tonnage leaving the port of Boston, as improbable as that seems. A Bostonian, Frederick Tudor, his industry was his brainchild. He spent many years refining ways to cut the ice, store it, transport it, and market it to Caribbean ports, and eventually even as far away as India. The arrival of the first shipload of Tudor ice in Calcutta in the 1830s is said to have created a sensation. So there was this ice industry that was growing by the 1830s into tens of thousands of tons per year harvested from Fresh Pond and Spy Pond. A volume that horse-drawn carts on muddy and rutty dirt roads could not keep up with the demand. And so what was needed was a railroad. So we get into sort of early railroad history now. The first railroad northwest of Boston was the Boston and Lowell, sponsored by the textile interest in Lowell. Shortly after it was built in 1835, a now little known line called the Charlestown Branch opened between Boston and West Cambridge. It was built to serve the ice industry. And it did so for several years. It became known as the Ice Railroad. Now, the way it connects with our own local railroad is that by building the first 4 miles west from Boston, it made the distance to Lexington that much shorter and encouraged the citizens of Lexington and what's today Arlington, encouraged them that they could finance their own extension of it. Notice that the Boston Lowell had, of course, bypassed Arlington, Lexington, Woburn. It had bypassed a number of other spots, and so the bypassed towns were left without access to this revolution in land transportation. It was a big concern for all of them. So the citizens of Lexington and West Cambridge got together. They financed their own extension from West Cambridge all the way out to Lexington, which they completed in 1846. Now, while they were doing that, another major system swooped in and acquired the Charlestown branch and built west through Concord to Fitchburg and eventually to upper New York State. So the Fitchburg Railroad became a rival of the Boston and Lowell, two powerful regional systems, and our little local railroad was caught in between them. I'm going to skip 20-some years here of history. The local railroad, the Lexington West Cambridge, struggled, neared bankruptcy by the years following the Civil War. And the Fitchburg was uninterested in it, but in 1869, the rival Boston and Lowell swooped in and bought it. That began kind of a golden age for rail service in our region, because the Boston and Lowell expanded service, lengthened the line, and it was the Boston and Lowell subsidiary called the Middlesex Central which extended the railroad from its previous terminus in Lexington all the way out to Concord. And so the railroad finally came to town for Bedford in 1873. So Lexington got its railroad in 1846, but Bedford not until 1873. And that it's hard today to sort of picture how heavily that weighed on people in Bedford, but it did. 27 years, only 4 miles to the railhead in Lexington. There was some connecting stagecoach service from Bedford to connecting with trains in Lexington, but it was an extra hour to Boston. It made doing business in Boston impractical, and this continued for 27 years. I think the extent to which that weighed on the citizens of Bedford is communicated by this quote from Brown, saying the stagecoach had lingered here much longer than in any other town within equal distance of Boston. I think between the lines there is a good deal of sort of frustration and bitterness over what had been the case before 1873. Well, once the railroad did arrive in Bedford, lots began to change. This is the Middlesex Central, as I said. It arrived in 1873, and as Brown wrote, the opening of the Middlesex Central in 1873 prepared the way for a decided change, which is now rapidly taking place, now being 1890. Men whose business centers are in Boston are establishing homes in the center of the town is fast becoming a residential village. In other words, the arrival of the railroad started Bedford on its path to becoming a suburb. It also encouraged the development of local manufacturing. Many of you are familiar with the New York Pharmaceutical Company and Dr. Hayden. There was a firm on Loomis Street called Bedford Lumber and Manufacturing, which was large enough to have steam-powered machinery and making window sashes and other construction products. The arrival of the railroad was a boon also for dairy farmers. I notice there's a panel in the back on the wall there that says that the Prescott Dairy got started in 1880. I think it's not an accident that its establishment and growth followed the arrival of the railroad. In the 1880s, there was something like 1,300 gallons of milk shipped to Boston every morning from Bedford alone. Bedford was a small producer compared to Lexington at that time, actually. It was also a boon for market gardeners, those who grew vegetables for market. Again, the access of the Boston market for the farmers was extremely important. List a little bit in the later chronology. So 4 years after the arrival of the railroad, a second railroad came to Bedford, the narrow gauge. Many of you have heard of, I'll say more about that later. It lasted only 6 months. But in 1885, the Boston and Lowell used much of its right-of-way to rebuild a line from Bedford to North Billerica. And so by 1885, our branch line had acquired its Y shape, Bedford being the junction point with a fork to Bedford and a fork to North Billerica. The 1880s and 90s were a time when the Boston Main was consolidating by acquiring all of its competitors. And by 1900, distinction between the Fitchburg on the one hand and the Boston Lowell on the other had disappeared. It was all then part of the Boston and Main. So the fact that there was two stations in Concord, one from the Middlesex Central, one from the Fitchburg, that the track never connected, is just a historical oddity. Okay, so in the railroad's first years and also in its last years, it was kind of a relaxed country kind of, you know, operation. And I think this photo by my friend Rick Connard kind of communicates that. These are passengers waiting to board in the little East Lexington Depot in 1973. Then service was down to one round trip to Boston per day. The equipment consisted of what were called rail diesel cars, or RDCs, self-propelled passenger cars. And you see the people waiting for the train. It looks like it could be out in the middle of, I don't know, yeah, somewhere out in the country rather than within actually 11 miles of Boston. Now, these people waiting for the train there in 1973 probably had no idea that the railroad they're about to ride was once a very busy, heavy-duty railroad. And that's shown by this graph where I've plotted over the railroad's entire history by decade the number of weekly passenger round trips that were offered. And one can see that during the Boston and Lowell's ownership, service, not only was the length of the branch increased, but service became much more intensive. And by 1900 then, there were 29 round trips operating as far out as Lexington. Add to that a daily freight, local freight train, you have 30 round trips, or 60 steam trains per day operating as far as Lexington, about half that number coming out to Bedford. 60 per day, that's a train every 15 minutes, approximately. So at one time, it was not a sleepy country operation. It was a very heavily used railroad. Well, what happened in 1900? Most of you have a good idea of much of that. Two things happened. The first thing was that trolley competition arrived. A street railway called the Lexington Boston was opened in 1900. This map is a little hard to read, but it began in Arlington Heights, went through Lexington Center. There were branches to Woburn and Waltham that don't concern us. In Bedford, it forked, as did the Lexington branch, with a branch to Billerica and then one to Concord. Throughout its length, it was within half a mile of the Lexington branch. Trolleys were cheap. At its peak, they operated every 15 minutes as far out as Bedford, and quickly then the trolleys siphoned away the local traffic from the railroad. Longer distance traffic was maintained much longer because the trolleys could not match the trains for speed or for in comfort, actually, for that matter. So the decline of longer distance service was more gradual. Well, that was the first of two blows. The second and more decisive one, well, first I'll show you some views of the trolleys at familiar places. Lexington Center, here's of course the first parish. I included this shot because of not just the trolley, but it shows how popular bikes were around 1900. Well, so the second blow to the railroad, of course, was motor vehicles. And about 1910, motor vehicle ownership in Massachusetts began to increase exponentially and continued to do so through the 1920s. It did so partly at the expense of the horse population. Blacksmith shops, which used to earn their living by shoeing horses, were converted to auto repair shops. The street railways did not do well in competition with motor vehicles either. Our local street railway that had been so successful in 1900 was gone by 1924. What was then the Middlesex and Boston had converted to motor vehicles. By that time, the tracks were mostly, although maybe not entirely torn up. Someone was telling me he thought he saw some remnants some years ago. Well, the motor vehicle expansion was not just at the expense of horses and the street railway, but of course at the expense of the steam railroad as well, and you kind of know how that one ended up. So now I'm going to take you on a tour of the branch. And what we're going to do is start in West Cambridge. And we'll go out this way. We'll explore the Concord line a little bit and the North Billerica Fork as well. Outbound in that direction was always, in terms of railroad publications and orders, was always considered to be north, not west. Inbound was south, not east. And I'll use those terms. There were lots of stations on the branch, 22 in all. None of them were alike, actually. It was before standardization. And we'll visit a good number of those as we take a trip through distance and time from West Cambridge out north on the branch. So what I'm gonna do is I'll be going northbound step by step. I'll be skipping back and forth over time and telling you what I hope will be some interesting things about some of the places. So the branch in modern times after 1927 and also in earlier times before 1870 began with a connection to originally the Fitchburg Railroad, later the Fitchburg Division of the Boston Main, now the MBTA's Fitchburg Line. In West Cambridge. So the tracks here are still there, although there are fewer tracks. Here's as a reference point is the Alewife Brook Parkway, and the Lexington Branch came in and joined the Fitchburg lines just a little bit east of the parkway. Almost nothing else in this aerial view from 1947 is still there. The big ponds were flooded clay pits that provided the raw material for the once extensive West Cambridge brick industry. Still there in 1947 was the New England Brick Company, and this was one of its clay pits. This pond is still there, actually. The LYFT station is right up in this area. Skipping ahead now to 1973. Yeah, okay. Sorry. So, skipping ahead to 1973, we have an outbound train in the early evening, train to Bedford, a pair of RDCs, led incidentally by number 6211, which is our Bedford's own restored rail diesel car at the Depot Park. Here is it in regular service. The high-rise buildings in the distance are the public housing along Ridge Avenue, occupying space that was once a flooded clay pit that you saw earlier. The white tanks in front of one of the buildings on the right were part of an Amoco bulk distribution facility that was demolished to make way for the T's Alewife parking garage. The parking garage is on that spot where those oil tanks once were. The train here, the outbound train in the evening, is approaching Route 2, and it's about to go through the underpass of Route 2. Here's now back to the late 1940s. Here is an afternoon commuter train departing Lake Street Station. You can just barely see the station in the far distance here. There's a truck on Lake Street crossing the track after the train. This train happened to be called the Paul Revere, and its morning counterpart was called the Patriot. It was very unusual, possibly unprecedented, for a lowly commuter train to be honored with such a name. And there's actually a story behind the Paul Revere and Patriot names. And here's the story. Back in 1926, the Boston Main abruptly announced that in 2 weeks' time it would eliminate two-thirds of the passenger service on the Lexington branch. I showed you a chart that shows the decline in passenger service over time. But in the 1920s, it was still viewed by citizens in the Minuteman towns as very important to the town's livelihood, real estate prices and, you know, and their values and so on and so forth. There was an enormous turnout at the public hearing to discuss this. Government officials, civic club representatives, and others jammed the room and caused a delay. In the meantime, as they had done back in April 1775 to counter a different kind of threat from Boston, the local citizens organized. They organized quickly and effectively, but not with muskets this time, but with testimony and legal motions. Something called the Lexington Branch Protective Committee was organized. It was chaired by Bedford's George Diamond, who actually went on the next year to become the city editor of the Boston Globe. It had representatives of each of the affected towns, and while they were maneuvering to delay the train-off proposal, they constructively met with railroad officials and negotiated a compromise schedule. And so instead of going down to just 3 round trips per day, they agreed on a schedule with 5 round trips and actually scheduled in a more effective way. I won't go into the sort of the details. And so a compromise was found that worked well for everyone, well enough that for it's the same schedule stayed in effect for the next 23 years. Now, it may have stayed that way in part because the Boston man didn't want to deal with these people anymore. But I think it was a good example of effective and constructive, you know, community, you know, organizing. Well, there were some hard feelings, as you can imagine, from the very abrupt way that the Boston Maine had approached this. And so at George Diamond's suggestion, the Boston Maine decided to honor the branch and its trains by giving one of them the name Paul Revere and the other the name Patriot. And those names lasted until 1958. There's a lot of detail here on the left. Don't be concerned about it. This is the compromise schedule that lasted for 23 years. The main point here is it did involve 5 weekday round trips. It was a good level of service for quite a long time. I've combined here a schedule with an internal document that had interesting, for rail historians, information about types of equipment and passenger counts. I'll just point out that 1077 means that over 1,000 riders per day still were using the Lexington branch at the time of this memo in 1942, or 500 round trips per day. So although the service had greatly declined from its peak in 1900, it was still an important thing for the community. Continuing our trip north, the Arlington Depot was soon after the point where the tracks crossed Mass Avenue. This map, as with most but not all of the others, actually dates from railroad documents that were prepared in 1914. The maps are, most of them are kind of upside down. North is down and south is up, but that's the way the railroad drew them, and I traced them. But you can see the Lexington Center Depot was just after the crossing here. At that time, there were trolleys on Mass Avenue. Train time in the 1920s was still a big deal. Here is an outbound train arriving at Arlington Center. It's unloaded some passengers, and you can see a big pile of express packages on a cart next to the baggage car, and over here is a truck waiting to deliver those to their destinations. Of course, the trains were, and if given a chance, I think still are, kid magnets, and so you see a certain number of kids there waiting to greet the train. That was the 1920s. This is the 1950s. The Arlington Depot now is looking a little bit worse for wear. It's lost its ornamental ironwork that it once had, but there's still dozens of people waiting to board the train to Boston on a March 1956 morning. Notice it's a steam train. In just 2 weeks from this March 1956 date would be the last steam operation on the branch. That person in the foreground maybe should consider getting off the track, I think. The grade crossing of with Mass Ave and Arlington Center was a perpetual headache for the railroad. The amount of carriage and wagon and then motor vehicle and trolley, traffic was difficult to deal with. Finally, in the 1930s, the railroad gave up on crossing gates there. I'll say more about crossing gates in a minute. And got permission to install a traffic signal that could be controlled by a watchman or, if no watchman was on duty, by the railroad crew. This is in 1932. They went so far as to get permission for the watchman to dress in a police uniform, thinking, I think, quite optimistically that this would help get the attention of Boston drivers. This is near that same spot in the 1970s. This is the local freight midday. It's just crossing Mass Ave. And the little stretch of track that it's on is the one piece of the branch that's been preserved in Arlington. It's in Whittemore Park. There's a little stretch of track that you might have seen, and that's it right there. So the third stop in Arlington was Brattle, originally with an S. The depot, this was taken around sometime in the 1890s. The depot that was there at the time was originally the depot at Arlington Center that had built in the 1840s. When the bigger one was built in Arlington Center, this one was moved to Brattle, Yankee Thrift. When it was moved, part of it was converted into a residence for the agent. This is something quite common in the Midwest and West, where the railroads preceded the population, so to speak. Very unusual in the East, but that's what was done in Brattle. There is an addition of a kitchen wing on the rear, and you can see the laundry hanging out back here. Most of the first floor was still the original waiting room. The opposite end of the building was still the 16-foot ceiling that had been utilized to add the second floor here. So that's Brattle in the 1890s. Skipping ahead, same spot in the 1930s. An underpass is now built for Brattle Street to go under the tracks. And a high platform made of big granite blocks has been built as a waiting area. So here's an inbound train, people waiting on the platform. The depot is just out of that left-hand picture, just out on the right, out of that photo. So a story that one of the regular conductors from the 1940s and 50s told is that there was a young woman who lived in the neighborhood, commuted to Boston for work, but just had a hard time getting out of bed and getting ready in the morning. She would regularly come running down Brattle Street, under the bridge, and up those stairs, waving to the train crew to wait for her, please. It was a different time, and people knew one another, if they're regular commuters, at least by face, if not by name. And instead of being irritated, they got a kick out of it, and they would yell to the crew, "Wait for Mary, wait for Mary." So Mary's stairs are still there, and they lead now up to the, to the bikeway. The last stop in Arlington going north was Arlington Heights. Again, there's a railroad connection here. Many of you know the area. It was farmland that was in the hilly and less expensive real estate in Arlington. The flat area on the east was still in demand for farming, but the hilly area was not so much. So it was acquired from the original descendants of the original farmers and subdivided in the early 1870s. It was done so specifically to be marketed to people that wanted to live out in the country and still commute to Boston. And the mechanism for doing it then in the 1870s was by train. This is long before cars, this is long before trolleys even. Horse railways had been established but were not very effective for most people. And so Arlington Heights was in that sense in part a creation of the railroad, and a very successful one in time. The left-hand photo shows the Lexington Branch right away at its sort of its peak when it was a double track railroad maintained for 45 mile per hour speeds. You can see the depot was up on the hill a little bit. Skipping ahead to the 1970s, we have a local freight making one of its visits in the last years. The Park Avenue overpass and the stairs leading up to it are still there, but the depot has been torn down. The stairs on the right, by the way, this is my last stairs story, by the way. The stairs on the right by that time had been closed off. You can see they're overgrown. There's a barrier. Well, today those stairs are still there. They've been reopened and they provide access to the to what is now the bikeway, which is where the train is. You got a glimpse of East Lexington earlier, the people boarding the morning train. Here's East Lexington on the left back in the 1890s. Look at the grounds. During that time period, station agents on the railroad competed with one another for prizes as to who had the most beautifully maintained plantings and other grounds around their station. You can see the wagons that have pulled up. This is pre-trolley, pre-automobile, of course. The area in the foreground on the left is now the parking lot of Lexington Toyota. Next stop going north was Pierce's Bridge. This is taken from the Maple Street overpass in Lexington. The little Pierce's Bridge Depot, which dated from the mid-1850s, is one I'm very sorry was not saved. It was quite a little gem in my opinion. Of course, the overpass is still there, a modern version of it, but this photo is impossible to take now because of the tree growth. You can't see the bikeway from that angle. Next station north was a spot called Monroe, and in contrast to most of the pictures I've been showing you, this spot still looks actually a lot like this today. The Monroe Depot was, if any of you know, the Seasons 4 Home and Garden Center in Lexington. I see some nods. Hopefully they're nods of assent and not sleep. But this is the depot was directly across the track or across the bikeway from Seasons 4. Picture on the right shows the where the depot was after it had been replaced by plantings. Now there's just a lawn area. The trees look pretty much the same, so it's still kind of a bucolic spot along the bikeway. Woburn Street was not a station, but it gives me a chance to talk about the crossing gates I alluded to earlier. These are actually the last set of crossing gates that still survived on the railroad. Manually operated crossing gates of this type started to be installed in the 1880s as traffic built up on the streets across the railroad. You can see just a little corner of the so-called crossing shanty that provided shelter for the watchman that was on duty to hand crank the gates up and down. At this time in 1949, the watchmen were on duty only during the morning and evening passenger rushes. And so when the local freight train, which is what this is, came out midday, they had no one to raise and lower the gates. And so you see a brakeman here on the pavement flagging the traffic. I said, these are the last surviving gates on the railroad. They made it, I think this is 49, they just made it until 1950, if I remember correctly. But there were once many of these on all the major crossings. What happened to them? A few were replaced by automatic flashers. As traffic declined on the railroad, many were simply eliminated, and the trains were forced to stop at the road, put a flagman down on the ground, cross, and then pick up the flagman. Lexington Center, I think everyone probably here has seen the Lexington Center Depot. This is what it looked like in the 1930s. In the right distance, this is the Lexington Freight House. This is Merriam Street, Mass Ave. It's out of the picture on the left. The photo is taken from a wooden footbridge that used to come down the hill and cross over the tracks and reach the depot. So typically quiet time around Lexington Center. But April 19th, 1875 was not a quiet time there by any means. Many of you know something about, I think, the centennial celebrations that Concord and Lexington put on. Separately, of course, because Concord and Lexington are always in competition. Both invited President Grant, who agreed to attend. He came with his cabinet. There were other politicians and officials that came that day also. The two towns had expected that perhaps 10,000 people would accept this open invitation to come out to Lexington and Concord on that day. It's estimated that the actual number was 100,000. So instead of twice the local population showing up, it was 20 times the local population. There was chaos in terms of getting from one place to another. These old photos are not great quality, but you can see this is taken from the top of a building in Lexington Center. The mob on the street, carriages, marching bands, pedestrians. It was, for a time, almost impossible, even as a pedestrian, to make any progress down Mass Ave. The Middlesex Central Railroad had a brand new depot in Boston, just a few years old, excellent facility. They put on extra trains in preparation for this, but they were completely overwhelmed. They turned away probably tens of thousands of people because they simply didn't have the equipment and trackage to accept them. A hint of that is seen here. See this long line of cars. This greatly exceeds what would have fit in any siding on the Middlesex Central. This is Merriam Street, by the way. These tents are probably caterers that were hired to provide a dinner for invited guests. And on top of the crowds, it was 26 degrees that day. And the food that had been ordered for the invited guests was served to them unintentionally frozen. And so some cynics have said that there were more fatalities that day than there were in 1775. Well, the 1950s were back to a more quiet existence around Lexington Center. This is not a classic car rally. Those are just commuters that park their cars for the day while they go to and from Boston. I've mentioned the local freight a couple of times. It was operated daily, and then by the 1950s, it was Monday, Wednesday, Friday. It would come out onto the branch after the morning passenger rush. Then it would have until the whole day, really, until about 4 o'clock to do its switching at each of the towns and service all of the freight customers. And then it would head north from Bedford before the evening rush, and so it stayed completely out of the way of passing trains. it was a little bit perplexing to local observers because it always went north and never came back south, and it was called by some the train to oblivion. But the way it did that is it went north to Lowell and then came back to Boston on the Lowell main line, avoiding any conflict with the passengers. So that was the reason that it did that. But here it is arriving at Lexington Center around noon. They would have stopped for water, had lunch probably with the agent, and then gone on to do their switching at the Lexington yard here. North Lexington was the last of five Lexington stops. The location was where the current day bike path crosses Bedford Street. You can see here's a car on Bedford Street. There's Bedford Street. We're looking railroad south. This is one of the more peculiar depots on the railroad. It predated the railroad, and that's why it's at kind of an odd angle relative to the tracks. They just left it there and bought it, converted it into a station. It was bought by someone and moved in the 1940s and replaced by this shack here. And here's our 6211 again on a morning trip in 1968. A time to catch some breath. Here's a chance to ask questions if there are any at this point before we get to Bedford. Yes. No, it was an employee. It was the station agent who was the person that handled the local railroad business and their family. I don't know what the financial arrangement was, but it was, as I said, it's much more common in the Midwest and West than in the East, which is what I thought was especially appealing about that photo. Yes?
In the area of the old railroad right-of-way behind where the new Lexington EPW is located, there seem to be a lot of traces of old side tracks and rail yard tracks and so forth back in there.
Yeah.
Is that accurate?
Yeah. I had a slide showing those sidings, then I left it out. Now I regret that. But just south of Revere Street, if you're going along the bikeway, if you look off, if you're going inbound, if you look off to the right, you'll see actually the remnants of two switches. Those led to Lexington Lumber, and when the tracks were torn up for the bikeway, they just didn't bother to remove those. So that's the, aside from the little section in Whittemore Park, that's the And there's some tracks in the pavement, west of South Road in Bedford also, in the truck company lot. But that's about all that remains. Yes.
You mentioned water stop. Were they able to put on enough coal in the morning to do all day long?
Yeah. Generally speaking, with steam locomotives, water was much more of an issue than fuel. They could probably do a couple of round trips on one load of coal, but for engines of the typical sort of medium size that were used out here, 15 to miles is about the limit for water. And 15 miles is the distance from Bedford to North Station, so they probably had water to spare for there, but would have had to stop in Boston, stop again in Bedford, so forth. Anybody else? You ready for Bedford? Okay, here we go. Many of you have heard about Bedford's narrow gauge railroad, and I think there's some misconceptions about what that was all about, so I'll take a minute to explain. Railroad historians have referred to the late 1800s as a period of narrow gauge fever. And this this syndrome arrived in Bedford in 1877. Track gauge is the distance between the inside edges of the rails, and the U.S. standard from almost the dawn of railroading and made officially by Congress in 1863 is 4 feet, 8.5 inches. Now the narrow gauge is anything less than that. And the narrow gauge movement was roughly 1870 to 1900. There are many proponents of it. Some had good arguments, some had arguments that were actually violated basic, you know, physics, but there are all sorts of things were advanced for why, by some people, for why narrow gauge railroads were a good idea. Summarizing a lot is that they were cheap to build. There was a practical way to build a railroad to a lightly populated area without any big industries. But per person, passenger mile, or per ton mile, they're more expensive to operate. And so they proved to be not really a very good idea. And so the fad had pretty much gone away by 1900. Ultimately, only about 7% of U.S. rail mileage was built as narrow gauge, and most of that was later converted or abandoned. And of the narrow gauge mileage, 95% was 3 feet, and only 1% was 2 foot gauge. What made Bedford's railroad famous was it was the pioneering ultra narrow 2 foot gauge railroad in North America. And that made it briefly nationally famous. People came to Bedford to see how the equipment would work. There was all sorts of speculation. Would the trains tip over because the rails were too close together? Would something else disastrous happen? Well, it turned out that the equipment worked fine from an engineering point of view. Financially, the railroad it couldn't pay its bills, and it was bankrupt in 6 months. It's the main promoter of the two-foot gauge was George Mansfield of Boston, who is basically a railroad hobbyist, but he had he devoted much of his life to promoting ultra-narrow gauge railroads. Here's where the track came in. This is sort of a right-side-up map. Track came in from Billerica along what's now the narrow gauge rail trail. There was a Y. A Y is a turning arrangement, like sort of analogous to a making a three-point turn in a car, but for locomotives. At that time, the Middlesex Central Depot was west of South Road, and that's where the narrow gauge passengers connect with standard gauge passengers. The inside the Y was a two-stall engine house, which housed this pair of extremely cute locomotives, the Ariel and its twin, the Puck.
A little hard to hear you.
Okay. Yeah, it's, right, okay. Is that better now? I get to looking at the screen and I get that
trend. It's not loud enough for the audience that's here today.
Yeah. Okay. Well, the narrow gauge era passed in just 6 months. The Bedford's equipment, or Bedford and Billerica's equipment, went to form the core of a narrow gauge network in rural Maine. Here's back to standard gauge railroading in Bedford. This is another one of the upside down maps. Here's the track coming from the direction of Lexington, Boston. The fork in the branch with the lines to Concord and to Billerica. Bedford's importance to the Boston main was not so much its traffic, but its being located at a junction point and having an engine terminal. The engine terminal was in the middle of this Y here, which is long gone. When the standard gauge line was built to Billerica from Bedford on much of the narrow gauge right of way, the depot was moved from this old spot west of South Road to its current location and placed equidistant between the two forks of the branch. At that time, the freight house was also moved there. Now, the freight house was the former narrow gauge engine house. When the narrow gauge was abandoned, it was repurposed as a freight shed, moved west of South Road to the vicinity of the depot, and then in the 1880s moved back to its present location. So it's a building that's had many lives. You can see the where the tail track of the Y crossed Elm Brook, there was this extremely luxurious facility, sanitary facility provided for the employees. Here's an inbound train ready to depart. It's on the Concord branch. This is the Billerica branch here in the foreground. And you can see the depot, of course, positioned between the two lines. If you look very carefully, you see train order signals at both ends of the depot, one for each of the lines. A very unusual kind of arrangement. Here's a locomotive that's come out on a Saturday with a train from Boston. It was Christmas Eve, actually, 1955. It's taking water from a standpipe here, and still existing next to the bikeway is the concrete foundation, and it has an interpretive sign that was almost destroyed by a fallen tree last winter, but has been repaired, I'm happy to say. Here's a view west from South Road of trains getting ready to depart for Boston in the morning. The building on the left was a section house, a place for storing track maintenance equipment. On the right was Middlesex Lumber and Fuel. It originally was Middlesex Coal and Grain. Today it's the Bikeway Source bike shop. Now we're going to go out to Concord. Passenger service to Concord ended in 1926 as part of the compromise schedule. So we're going to have to ride a freight train. Here we are in 1939, ready to depart the Bedford Depot for Concord. One of the four stations in Bedford was that at West Bedford, a rather modest facility. This photo is undated. The overpass there is Concord Road, and the track went under that. The overpass was built by the trolley company, actually. It was required to do that by the state DPU because they wanted to discourage grade crossings between trolley lines and steam railroads. And so the road was elevated to create that overpass. And then, of course, later after the railroad was abandoned, the road grade was brought back down. There would have been an overpass there if the bike path to Concord had been approved. There was, after the 1880s, there was not very much on the Lexington branch at Concord, just a few sidings. Even by this time in 1939, the depot has been sold or leased to a newspaper, actually. And so this is their train arriving at Concord Center. After 1927, there was no service at all beyond Concord Center. But earlier than that, the track went all the way to a location that's actually been recently in the news. On the way there were two river crossings, the first the Sudbury, then the Assabet. I love this old photo. Charles Hodgman was a photographer who had a studio in Bedford and took not a lot of railroad pictures, but took some really excellent ones. And so I've worked a Charles Hodgman photo into here. Now at the end or nearly the end of the Concord fork of the branch was a station originally called Prison and later renamed Reformatory. And it's across the street, across today's Route 2 from what is now MCI Concord. Of course, that's been in the news recently. It's scheduled to be closed, I gather, in the summer. You can see The depot there was actually part depot, part hotel, hotel for visitors to the prison. Second and third floor was hotel rooms. First floor was a depot and a restaurant. Here's the prison across the street. Elm Street then is today's Route 2. We're back to Bedford now. We're going to ride a freight, different year, different train, up north to Billerica. The last stop in Bedford on that fork to Billerica was Bedford Springs. A lot of you have heard of Dr. William Hayden. He was the proprietor of the New York Pharmaceutical Company of Bedford Springs, and also the Springs House resort. He was influential, actually, in bringing the Middlesex Central and later the narrow gauge to Bedford. Was during its last months, actually, was president of the narrow gauge company. The here's the Bedford Springs Depot in its last months, I think. Just beyond it is today's Sweetwater Avenue. The little freight shed here on the north side was built to for the New York Pharmaceutical Company to do shipments. And of course, the former New York Pharmaceutical Company factory is now condominiums, and they're next to Fond Lake. As with Concord, Billerica did not have really extensive rail facilities. It had kind of a nice little depot, but just a couple of sidings and not a lot of traffic. Here's the exception to what I said earlier about things on the branch usually not affecting the overall Boston Main system very much. In 1912, the Boston Main decided that with all their consolidation, they needed to build a new, modern shop complex for locomotive and car repairs that was centralized. They acquired several hundred acres of land between the main line from Boston Lowell, this is the original 1835 main line, and the Lexington branch, it's coming up to join that at North Billerica. This is the land that the railroad bought, and they installed more than 100 miles of track, several big buildings, and centralized their heavy car and locomotive repairs at the this shop complex in North Billerica. Some sense of the scale of it, you can see here is the locomotive shop building. Whole locomotives could be picked up and moved around by the gantry cranes, and I think I counted something like two dozen locomotives under repair at one time here in 1917. There's still some remnants of that complex. It's called now called Iron Horse Park. It's in various stages of decay, but still some traces of it. It's not public property. I've been kicked off the property a few times myself, and so I don't necessarily recommend it for a picnic outing. A branch ended at North Billerica, and this is the North Billerica depot. This is the Lexington branch coming in next to the depot. This is the double track Boston to Lowell main line. The branch ended up ended beyond these freight cars here. The North Billerica depot for a time was very much endangered. It had gone through a history like that of many old depots. It was sold by the railroad to a lumber company. It was not found useful. It was left derelict. It was on the verge of being razed when a woman whose name escapes me now, but she was a former town historian of Billerica, resident of that neighborhood, got wind of the plans to demolish it and organized and got support for preserving the depot, and even got support from the T to restore it, and it's once again a viable commuter stop. Continuing with the theme of preservation. Like many of you have seen, the Lexington Depot was acquired. It was sold by the railroad to a bank. It operated as a bank office for many years. It was acquired by the Lexington Historical Society in 1999, and the exterior restored by them. As with a number of the depots, there's nothing inside, I think, that's original, but the exterior looks very much like it did at the end of a train service. Well, what about rail preservation in Bedford? An argument can be made that rail preservation in Bedford really had its origin on April 1st, 1992, as told to me by the late Jim Shea. He was driving to work that day and noticed that there were machines tearing up the track remnants in Bedford, unused for many years, but now needed to be removed for the bikeway construction. He went home, got his camera, decided that the railroad shouldn't completely just disappear undocumented. Began to think about the idea of maybe establishing a photo, maybe supplemented by a bench or something next to the bikeway, and thought about it some more, got together with some like-minded people. Began to think about more ambitiously about, gee, could Bedford have a display passenger car? He contacted the T. They had three of them left. They were all in derelict condition among the trees and overgrowth in the former Billerica Shops area. Bedford got its choice of the three for $1. It cost tens of thousands of dollars, by the way, to move them to Bedford and years and years and years to restore them, but this is how it got started. This was the condition of the car when it was picked out as the most restorable of the three. In 1994, as the deal was being made with the T, Jim also learned or realized that there were still two surviving 1870s railroad buildings in Bedford. One of them, this bakery, heavily disguised. This is the building that was the narrow gauge engine house, Middlesex Central freight house, Boston and Maine freight house. It became a feed and grain dealer. It became the clubhouse for a VFW chapter, a bakery, maybe some other things. It's a building with many lives. It was still here, original freight house location, as the bikeway had just been completed the year before. The passenger depot also was fortunately still in existence. It had been sold to an electrical contractor, a second floor added inside, taking advantage of the high ceiling, and it was used for storage and office space, and starting to look worse for wear by 1994. The area around the depot was not really one of Bedford's proud garden spots. This is what the freight yard looked like then, and this is what it looks like today. Jim and like-minded folks organized the Friends of Bedford Depot Park, wrote grant applications that succeeded in acquiring more than $1 million of federal funding. The town meeting got on board. It's been supplemented by community preservation and other funding since then. And after many years of work to restore the buildings and the rail car, looks like this today. The depot, that was 2009. The depot restoration took a little bit longer. This is the 1873 passenger depot now. Again, outside, the exterior looking very much like the original. The interior of the RDC looks like this. The seating area is restored to like new condition. There are posters with original ads from the 1950s for this new kind of equipment. So there's what the outside looks like. On the left, you can see actually the bike shop, former Middlesex Colin Gray in the distance. And so that's where we are as of today. Here's the proverbial message from our sponsor. Friends of Bedford Park was mentioned earlier. Check out our website, come visit. We'll be opening probably in mid-April on weekends, probably 11 to 5. Stop by, any of you have would like to send me a message, there's my email also, and then there's the book that was mentioned earlier. There's some flyers on the table. We'd be happy to sell you a copy at the Freight House or by mail. So I know this went kind of long, but thank you very much for your attention. And if there are other questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Yes. Sorry, I didn't hear that.
When and why was service to Bedford discontinued?
Commuter trains in general were getting less and less economically viable in the 50s and 60s, and it amounted to expense versus ridership, and so the last train to Bedford was in January 1977. The T had actually threatened to cut off service as early as 1965, and then they reversed themselves at the last minute. So service to Bedford had been threatened for a long time. Yeah, well, that spur to Hanscom was built in, I think, 1942. Of course, it was to provide construction materials and supplies for the new the new Air Force base. It was a source of traffic for the Lexington branch for maybe 20, 25 years. By the 1970s, there was very little traffic left, and so it was. I don't know exactly when it was torn up.
Just to comment, I believe that what happened was that the branch was used to transport Indonesian gasoline, so I think this was the plane of the port.
Yeah.
And as that moved over to jet fuel, they started bringing it in by truck.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, first it was the construction materials, and then, as you say, aviation fuel would have been a big item, and then maybe just occasional supplies after that. But it was very few carloads per year by 1970. Yes.
I'm just curious if anyone really looked at the financing over time. Was this partly just people demanded service and it was provided regardless of cost or investment? This is very quaint and interesting. It provided some good service.
Yeah.
But I was wondering if anyone really looked at cost or system, or this was more like a lot of things we do episodic.
Well, while the railroad was the Boston and Maine's property, of course they were always looking at their expenses. It was not publicly disclosed information unless there was an abandonment hearing, in which case one could get insights into what they said their costs and revenues were. The MBTA came into the picture in 1965, and so the economics starting then were really sort of T-driven, and I did not attempt to really sort out what their their costs and expenses are.
What is the current status of the railroad right-of-way along where the branch went? Is it rail banked or whatever?
Right. Technically, the Lexington branch is not abandoned. In the 1980s, there was legislation that established a status called rail banked. Its purpose was to keep intact the land that had been used by railroads for possible future transportation use. And that actually is the Lexington branch's status. The land is owned by the T. It was purchased by the T from the Boston and Maine in actually 1970, late 76. It's rail banked. Now, the prospects for the restoration of rail service, I would say, are not very good. That's its official status. Yes?
I understand that the bridges across places like Bravo Street were all built to railroad specifications. Are you familiar with that?
Which street were you referring to?
The bike path goes across the street.
Sure. Yeah.
I think
all of there may be some exception, but I think all of the bridges on the bikeway that are overpasses are all the original railroad bridges.
Okay.
And so yes, they were built to handle much heavier loads than.
There's a lot of rebar in that stuff.
Yes.
Why was the narrow gauge a thing? Why did people think that was a good idea?
Well, having smaller equipment, shorter engines, shorter cars, first of all, because they were smaller, they were cheaper. And because their length was less, they could operate on sharper curves. And so it allowed narrow gauge railroads to go around hills instead of through or over them. And so that's the main thing that made narrow gauge construction costs lower. So it was a cheap way to bring rail service to lightly populated areas, but it was operationally it was over time it was expensive. Well, thanks again for your attention. Your questions.
Now, just before you go, I was talking to Phyllis Cook when we first gathered. She said she'd ridden the Boston and Maine Railroad. Who else? Who's ridden that railroad? Hey. Anytime. Hey. Oh, that's neat. There you go.
You should be able to get out of South Station and get to Alston in about 7 minutes at the Alston Station, which is now a sports bar.
Good. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming. See you next time.